Hello, romance book lovers. Welcome to Tales from the Heart. I am Jenna Harte, and each week I post new episodes from my stories of crime and passion. Right now we're listening to Old Flames Never Die, book 2 of the Valentine Mysteries. This week is episode 13, chapter 18, where we find out if Tess is going to forgive Jack. Now, if you'd like to read along or get ahead in the story, you can get Old Flames Never Die from your favorite ebook retailer, or you can save by buying direct from me. You can find out the details over at jennahart.com/Valentine. Now, Old Flames Never Die is the second book in the Valentine Mystery series. And if you missed book 1, Deadly Valentine, you can listen by checking early episode postings, or if you'd like to read it, you can get the book for free at my website, jennahart.com. Now, Tales from the Heart is posted to podcast platforms and YouTube each week. But these episodes are edited to censor out the intimate content, of which there is a significant amount for this week's episode. So if you'd like to have a version that includes the spicy bits, plus get early access to the episodes, behind the scenes information about the stories, bonus content, and more, please join me over at Ream. You can learn more at reamstories.com/Jenna Harte. Now, never miss the mystery or romance by hitting the subscribe button. And remember that all the details and links you might need are just a click away in the description. Now, snuggle up, get comfy, and enjoy the show.
Chapter 18. Jack had made the decision to do better at letting Tess set the pace of their relationship. But he couldn't be sure she was even going to let him back into her life. She'd let him tag along on her investigation, but so far she hadn't given him any indication that she'd forgiven him or that she would be giving him another chance. Once her door closed, he went next door to his room. He tipped the bellboy, then dumped his overnight bag in the closet. He considered sending her flowers or ordering the most decadent chocolate confection off the room service menu for her. But he knew he needed to wait. A skill he wasn't very good at when it came to here. He opened the door adjoining his room to hers. Her side was still closed. He leaned close to see if he could hear her, and then decided it was a pathetic move. He grabbed a $12 bottle of water from the minibar and drank it in several swallows. He moved to the window to look at the view of Central Park. It was a beautiful day, and under normal circumstances, he'd be walking through the park hand in hand with Tess. The wait was excruciating until finally he couldn't take it anymore. He tossed the empty water bottle on the table and headed to the adjoining door, frantically thinking of some dumb excuse to check on her so she didn't think he was pushing her. Just as he reached out to knock, the door opened and swung back. He stood looking at her. The desire to touch her forced him to thrust his hands into his pockets.
Everything all right?
Yes. There's even a phone in the bathroom. I guess so I can call for help if I fall in.
Jack grinned. There she was. It still didn't mean he was forgiven, but at least she was acting like the Tess he knew. He stepped back from the door.
Want to come in? I haven't checked the bathroom for a phone, but I know I have a fully stocked mini bar. Want something to drink?
She shook her head to the drink, but stepped into his room.
I spoke to Daniel.
That was not what Jack wanted to talk about, but he wasn't about to complain.
Did you give him your report?
Yes. And I thanked him for helping you. And for helping me.
Jack studied her, wanting to believe she was getting ready to forgive him, but afraid he might be reading the signs wrong.
He's a good friend.
It couldn't have been easy for you to go to him.
No, but I think it was harder for him.
She nodded.
But he didn't do it for me,
Jack said.
No. He knows I love you.
To hear her say the words filled his heart. He was sure it was bulging through his chest.
But do you forgive me?
She nodded.
Yes.
Relief flooded his body. He wanted to hold her, but when he moved toward her, she stepped back, moved around him to the couch.
I have a few things to say before we start with the hugging.
She was torturing him, but he'd endure it.
Okay.
First, I don't do well with ultimatums.
I know, and I'm sorry about that. It won't happen again. You set the pace this time, Tess.
She held up a hand.
My turn to talk. Remember?
Right.
He gave her a rueful smile, and she settled against the back of the couch.
I know I'm not blameless in all this. I said we didn't know how to be together or communicate, and then I made it hard to do both. I kept thinking that if we were right, we wouldn't have problems. The truth is, I don't know how to do this. Except for Tom and Helen, I don't have any idea what a solid relationship looks like. And they always looked like they never disagreed. But Daniel explained to me that that wasn't true. They always disagreed about Asa.
Jack owed Daniel a lot more than he thought. Not only had Daniel helped him get to Tess, but apparently he'd given advice that suggested she needed to give love a chance.
I know you said that people can be in love and disagree, but all I could think about was arguing was one step closer to losing you.
No, never.
Jack stepped towards her but kept his hands safely in his pockets.
The truth is, I'm afraid. And even after today, I'll probably need more reassurance.
Whatever you need, I'll do it.
She reached up and pressed a finger to his lips.
I need you to let me finish.
At her touch, his hands came out of his pockets, wanting to pull her to him. But her words stopped him. Instead, he took her hand, kissed her palm, and brought it to his heart. He nodded at her to let her know that he'd try to keep quiet.
Like I said, I'll still need reassurance, and you're probably going to keep pushing. It's just what it is. We just need to figure out how to keep these issues from getting in the way.
He nodded.
You told me once that you thought I was looking for an excuse to prove my fears right. I'll admit there were times I wondered when the other shoe would drop. Partly because I'm afraid that true love doesn't exist, and partly because I'm still baffled at how you can love me the way you do.
Jack desperately wanted to tell her why he loved her, how he'd always loved her, but he could see she wasn't done talking.
But I wasn't looking for a way out. Honestly, I don't think I was all the way in.
At first, Jack wondered what the difference was. Either way, she had one foot out the door. But then he realized that she hadn't been pulling away. She couldn't take from him what she hadn't yet given. She blew out a breath and looked a little terrified. She looked up at him with her amber-colored eyes, swallowed hard, and said,
I'm all in.
Jack couldn't believe that those three words could make him happier than hearing she loved him. But they did. God, he wanted to hold her, kiss her. But he held back, waiting for her next move.
We can get to the hugging now.
Thank God.
She was in his arms before he finished the words. He pulled her tight against his body and held on as if his life depended on it. His hands cradled her face, his eyes tenderly looking into her own.
I love you, Tess.
He lowered his lips to hers, kissing her with such tenderness and love. It made all her reservations melt away. She knew they would have bumps in their relationship, but if she trusted in him, they'd work them out. He pulled back, looked down on her again.
You won't be sorry.
You might be.
He smiled and
never. I was terrified you wouldn't forgive me.
Anyone who is willing to ask for help from his nemesis and face his phobia has to be serious.
The flying part was hard.
He gave her his pitiful look.
Poor baby.
I think you enjoyed watching me suffer.
Maybe a little.
It was worth it.
He kissed her again because he could, because he needed to.
So what happens now?
What do you mean?
Wanna go on a date?
Tess's brows grew together.
We don't have to start at the beginning. And I don't need romance.
We're in New York, and I'm hungry.
What do you have in mind?
Do you trust me?
Absolutely.
He grinned, kissed her again, and then took her out for an evening on the town.
One thing Tess loved about Jack was that he was romantic, but not in the traditional way. Sure, he kept her stocked with chocolate, but when it came to other romantic gestures, he always surprised her. He could have taken her to the fanciest, most expensive restaurant in Manhattan, but instead he took her for pizza.
You won't ever have pizza as good as Lombardi's,
he explained. After eating it, she suspected he was right. They headed back uptown to Rockefeller Center, where he paid for a trip to the top of the Rock.
I know the Empire State Building is the romantic one,
he said.
But when you're at the top of the Empire State, you can't actually see it.
He was right about that, too, as she looked at the famous building in the twilight, with brightly colored lights decorating its facade. The evening was warm, the city vibrant, so they decided to walk the few blocks back to the hotel. He lifted their linked hands and kissed her knuckles.
I should have done more of this for you.
You kiss my hand a lot. In fact, I wash them more so you don't get germs.
He grinned down at her.
That's not what I meant, but thank you. What I meant was court you.
I don't need that.
They walked into the lobby of their hotel.
But you mentioned once that we didn't date.
I know, but I didn't mean that I needed romance and flowers. I thought we needed dating to get to know each other better before living together.
They stepped into the elevator, and Jack pressed the button for their floor.
And now?
And now, I figure I know you, and you know me pretty well. Not that I don't sometimes feel like I'm on a roller coaster, but dating would have simply delayed the inevitable.
He pulled her to him and held her.
Inevitable, eh?
She tilted her head back to gaze into his brilliant eyes.
Jack, I may have been afraid, but I've always loved you and hoped that everything you promised would come true.
I can't tell you how much you're saying that means to me.
As if to prove it, he pulled her close again, held her tight. The doors of the elevator opened. He took her hand, led her to her room. Outside her door, he kissed her, and Tess got the feeling he was dropping her off.
I think I remember you saying something about getting lucky.
She waggled her brows. Heat flashed in his eyes.
I didn't mean that kind of lucky. I was hoping for another chance. I'm not blowing it this time.
You weren't sure you'd get a second chance, hence the two rooms.
He shrugged.
I didn't want to presume.
That's not like you.
It's amazing what someone can do when properly motivated.
And what about now?
What about now?
Are you going to presume now? Or do you need some motivation?
Before he could answer, she cut him off with a kiss. She gripped his shirt and pulled him close, pressing her body against his to let him know she wanted him to stay. She smiled when he groaned, but then he pulled away. At first, Tess worried. Had she missed something? Hadn't they made up? But when she looked into his blue-green eyes, she saw desire mixed with uncertainty.
Why the long face?
Because.
His voice was tight.
Because why?
Because I want to do the right thing.
Making love would be wrong?
Yes, no, I mean.
He exhaled a long breath.
A few days ago, you moved out because things were going too fast. You wanted to slow down. I'm trying to keep it slow.
I don't want slow.
She surprised him by slipping her fingers in his waistband and pulling him back to her.
Tess.
I know now that we can't slow down or go back. I have to trust in you and me. In us.
He grinned, looking ridiculously happy. Why did she question his love for her when looking at him? The way he looked at her made it so clear. He grabbed the key card from her hand and opened the door. Once it was closed, she found her back against the door. She settled into the curve of his body. His lips kissed her closed eyelids.
I'm glad you didn't make me wait.
I don't know why you thought I would.
I guess I thought I owed you more, needed to make up for more.
She managed the energy to open her eyes.
I don't want you to feel like you have made something up to me, or that you have to jump through hoops. I was partly to blame, too.
I can't promise I won't mess up again, but I can promise that I won't second-guess you or dismiss you. You said earlier that Asa was always an issue between Helen and Tom, but Liv is not an issue between us, not anymore.
Did something happen?
If you're asking if I learned something that could help your investigation, the answer is no. I always knew that Liv wasn't very deep, but when I really thought about what you said and considered her behavior, I realized I was wrong to doubt you. I don't know if she killed Charles. I'd still be surprised if she did, but she definitely is playing some sort of game and I don't want to be a part of it. I guess you already know about the baby.
Guilt consumed Tess as she remembered betraying Jack's confidence by sharing Liv's baby news with Daniel.
About it not being Charles? Yes.
I know Daniel wasn't supposed to say anything, but when he said there was no way that baby could have been Charles's, I not only felt duped, but also guilt over the way I treated you. How could I have been so dense?
I've been wondering that same thing. He grinned.
How do you put up with me?
You kiss good.
At least I've got one good thing going for me.
Tess smiled, but underneath she felt fear. She needed to come clean about what she'd told Daniel. Would her confession destroy their reunion?
Jack?
Hmm.
I told Daniel about Liv's baby.
What about it?
I didn't know about the baby until you told me. I'm the one who told Daniel. I might not have, except that I knew Charles had had a vasectomy.
She glanced down, unable to look him in the eyes.
It doesn't prove she killed him. She has an alibi, so I don't know why I thought it was important, but...
It's okay, Tess.
She looked up into his blue-green eyes and saw understanding.
First of all, Daniel never brought it up. Liv did. That means you didn't need to confess all this.
But I did. You told me about being with Liv when she was married and about the kiss.
I'm glad you told me, and I'm glad you told Daniel. That bit of news pushed me to recognize what a mistake I was making.
You're not mad?
No.
He gave her his best smile, dimple and all.
I'm not mad.
This trip is a bust, too. Turns out I owe you an apology. There's no way Liv killed Charles.
No, Liv's up to something. Maybe not murder, but there's something going on in her head.
Tess remembered Shelby's comment about Liv needing a sugar daddy. She wondered if Jack realized that he was Liv's next conquest.
But I don't think the trip's a bust. Here we are back together, and we're in New York City. Plus, I got to see where women come to get detailed.
Some women, I suppose. Not all women are so concerned with their chassis.
I love your chassis.
He reached down and gave her backside a squeeze. Tess slipped her hand down his abdomen and lower.
And I like your stick.
Careful, counselor. I'm about to shift gears.
Thank you so much for listening to this episode from Tales from the Heart. I hope you enjoyed it, and we'll be back to find out what happens next. Now that Jack and Tess are together, what is going to happen with the investigation of Charles Danforth's murder? Now remember, you can listen to full uncensored episodes over at reamstories.com/Jenna Harte. And if you'd like to read along or get ahead in the story, you can get Old Flames Never Die from your favorite ebook retailer or save by buying direct from me. All the details and links you might need are just a click away in the description. Don't miss the next episode. Hit the subscribe button so you'll know when it's posted. Thank you again for listening, and until next time, this is Jenna Harte, wishing you peace, love, and happily ever after.